a bit loud in here tonight.
A bit loud. Good evening and welcome to The Pink and Show live, your dedicated Norwich City televisual hour of rants, raves and randomness. And I can assure you that's not a special for the international break. We are live, as I said, right now on YouTube and on Mustard TV in Norwich, ready to sift through the latest Canaries stories. My phone's going off. And look ahead to the resumption of Championship action this weekend. It's not Brian Gunn, producer Jake, sorry. And who better to do that with than the wonderful man that is legendary City winger Darren Eadie, plus a pair of fine City columnists, my football writer Steve Cook and Eastern Daily Pressman Ian Clarke. And I can't remember whether I've said it yet or not, but we are live tonight. And all you need to do to get in touch with us right here in the studio on this very phone, which will probably ring in a minute, is just post to the live chat on our YouTube feed or send us your tweets, including the handle at Pinken. And remember, you can even call us and find your way right through to the studio. They're definitely ready for it in the gallery. And just call 01603 63006. Right, let's get going then with this week's headlines. Jacob, happy to assist. You don't understand how loud the bongs are. It took too long coming and then ended all too abruptly with that strange early substitution. But it's fair to say Jacob Murphy impressed on his first stint away with England's under-21s. Plenty of action and assist to his name, and surely much more to come. The McGovernor still believes. Michael McGovern is back as number one, both here and at Windsor Park, of course. He helped Northern Ireland take a step closer to World Cup qualification on Sunday. Now the keeper has eyes on taking that five-point gap to the top six, ringing it with both his bare hands and gate-crashing the playoff party. We can but dream, Michael. Hoyle's war and the hard ball bid. Nice and quiet, Jake. Well done. City still clumped on. Oh my God. Are we live? City still haven't been able to confirm their new sporting director is in place and working away. As Huddersfield chairman Dean Hoyle digs his heels in over compensation for Stuart Webber's departure. Meanwhile, the head coach names come and go. Fleetwood's Juve Rosler is the current bookies' favourite, although a few have held that title now. It's game time. A lot. If you feel it's been quiet on the pitch recently, you'd be right. Come Friday, City will have played just once in 20 days. Then come Saturday, Norwich have five games in the space of just 17 days, including trips to Villa Park and Huddersfield in the next week alone. It's about to get busy, people. And thank you, Pete. The tributes have flowed for Norwich City stalwart Peter Oldfield, who died at the weekend following an illness. Peter worked on all sorts of things behind the scenes at Carrow Road, escorted City's man of the match to their post-match duties, and often stayed for a quick chat and a joke with some of us journalists. Peter adored the football club, and as Norwich City rightly said, he will be sorely missed. Darren, Steve, Clarkey. Ian, I can't call you Ian.
You can call me Clark.
Thank you so much for coming in. How was your international breaks? Enjoyable?
Not particularly. It was nice to see England, actually. I thought they played quite well. Youthful exuberance.
A bit of, and big games for Gareth Southgate, really, to get involved
yeah,
in.
Yeah, but also Jacob as well, long overdue, getting his opportunity in the 21s, played pretty well. And that thing with that as well, I know from my own experience, you come back with so much confidence. It gives you a real lift, so hopefully you'll come back firing all cylinders for these next really important games.
Did you find it a bit strange that, I know he played 90 minutes in the first game against Germany, wasn't it? The second one, he got pulled off after 32 minutes with an assist and admittedly 2-0 up against Denmark, but it didn't seem like it was prearranged or anything.
No, I think it was purely a tactical reasons. But he'll be disappointed, but the fact that he has played as well as he has done will be a bonus to him and to Norwich, more importantly.
Anything clock your attention, guys, elsewhere? We had Scotland, Northern Ireland. That was about it, really.
No, I think the Jacob Murphy one was the one for me, because we talk about him building confidence over those games, but does it not take a bit of a battering if you go off after half hour?
I don't think so. I think if the reasons would have been explained to him as well, it wouldn't have been anything to do with his performance. So I think it's the way he's played, he'll be really pleased, and the manager wouldn't have just taken him off and not said anything to him. Yeah.
And he played a whole 90, hadn't he, the game
He
before.
Had, that's true.
So enough, that's sort of 2 hours in a few days, so I think it's great news for him. And he must learn so much being with the country's best young players.
And he must get called up more now, surely. I mean, given he was only a sort of a late call-up, wasn't he, for someone pulling out?
Because he's 22.
Yeah.
And he's under 21.
Yeah, so I think you have to be under 21 the January of the start, the year that the season started.
Yep.
So he was 20 January 2016.
Okay.
I mean, Nathan Redmond.
Right, Yakubu could qualify. He's 21, isn't he? I believe.
I think Nathan Redmond played for the under 21s when he was about 24.
So. I think.
Did
I
you?
Quite old
How
well.
Did you manage that then? Yeah. Did they just not check?
I think it was my size.
Got away with it. Got
away with it.
You still can, Darren.
Hey, live the dream. You never know. Don't give up on it. Well, Stephen Naismith scored for Scotland. We had Russell Martin playing in their Scotland qualifier. Should have scored, probably. Should have been allowed. And Michael McGovern, busy with, well, he wasn't actually that busy with Northern Ireland. But, you know, a little bit of him saying how he's kind of focusing now on Norwich, doing some useful work going forward.
I think there's always a danger when players are on international duty to get injuries, but I still think that when they're away with some really good crop of players, they must come back with confidence and with just what they've learned from being in that sort of environment.
Unless you're away with Scotland. Because the way they played, I thought they were dreadful. That on the other side can turn it the other way, the flip side of actually going away and playing with your country and getting all that confidence from being and doing that. I'm not sure Russell Martin and Naismith are going to come back from that thinking, God, that was brilliant, I feel on top of the world, because they weren't great.
It was interesting listening.
Not just them personally, I mean the team and the environment. Team, right.
Indeed, it was interesting listening to Russell Martin as well speak before the game, because a lot of the stuff he was saying about the negativity around the place and all this sort of stuff, he's basically had to have, he had here, didn't he? And Chris Martin scored the winning goal. Mm. He got booed when he came on. But a Beckles boy scoring for Scotland? Steve?
Yeah, Chris McMartin.
Along with Russell McMartin.
He's an interesting player, isn't he? I mean, I always rated him when he was at Norwich. And he's the sort of player that I think was probably underrated when he was here for maybe a variety of reasons, some to do with his behaviour off the pitch, perhaps. But he scores goals, doesn't he?
You'd have him back now, wouldn't you?
I would, yeah. I think
with Strachan as well, the reason Chris Martin got booed is because I think there's a lot of people, especially Scottish people, that feel there's other players that deserve an opportunity that he hasn't picked. Yeah. So it wasn't anything personal, really, to Chris Martin, I think.
We've got to flag up the under-23s play in the Premier League International Cup semi-final against Sunderland at Carrow Road on Friday evening. It's free to attend. Get along. That should be good fun, that. Right, we're about to be joined by a special guest. But before that, let's make up for the championship shortfall by watching producer Jake fail to be a goalkeeper against our latest Fallon de Floor challengers.
Hello and welcome to the Pink and Show's Fallon de Floor Challenge, where we are still here at Goals in Norwich, where we've been taking part with a couple of the local five-a-side teams. Now, last week we saw one of the teams score 3 in 2 minutes and 2 seconds.
Yeah.
You reckon you can beat that?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Yeah, so, of course. You know, you're always, very confident. Right, should we bring in our first player?
Yeah.
Who is it? Who's in? Come on.
It's Tom Fisk. He's a big guy, as you can see. And he was born in 1966, so you can tell.
Yeah. Right, super stuff. Who's in next, please?
Jack Edwards. He's actually an actor, so he's come on Thursday to give us a cardio session.
A real actor?
Yeah, yeah.
Right. Next, in the front shirt.
We've got James Shreve.
All right.
Yeah, he's a bit of a twinkle toes, so yeah. Bit of good with his feet, so yeah, it's decent.
And then, swap over.
And we got Mr. Pretty Boy, William Foster. He actually played twice and knocked both his teeth out, so.
And then you take one at the end, right? Yeah.
Hmm?
You're going to take one?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, what you like? You good?
I'm right, you know. Well, right. Some saying that much.
You've seen the competition?
Yeah, of course.
And you're pretty close. Basically, the rule is if you hit the target, you're going to score.
Yep.
Yeah, so you're going to go 10 spins as quick as you can, score past me. You've got to beat 3 in 2 minutes and 2 seconds.
All right, cool.
Come on,
let's see.
Go! No, I'm not safe!
Jersey! Oh, all of that!
Super stuff, boys. Some great experience and great balls there. You scored two in a time of 1 minute and 55. Woo! Not bad going, boys. So really good time, but unfortunately the lads from last week beat you, but thanks for playing.
Could watch that Mega Nuts.
This is nice.
All day. We should just watch that for the next half.
This is nice, isn't it? And let's have a look at what that does to the Fallon DeFlor leaderboard, shall we? If you fancy smashing some balls, we'll show you how in a bit. But there we are. They were there. Is that just so we linger on Team Mustard?
I still went with the wrong foot.
If you fancy smashing some balls, at producer Jake, I'm sorry, but time's up. The last of our Fallon DeFlor challenges for this season have been lined up, but if you want to get ahead of the game for next season, all you have to do is email your details to sport@mustardtv.co.uk and someone will take care of the rest. Yeah. Now, we have a very special guest in the studio, all the way from Australia. Oh dear, did I just do that? I'm so sorry.
I knew someone would.
Yeah, that's terrible, isn't it? Lee Woodrow, Brisbane Canary. Ooh, yeah. Thanks so much for joining us.
Hi everyone, thanks for inviting me.
Happy birthday.
Thank you very much.
Today?
It is indeed. It's today.
Can I ask you how old?
It's the big 40.
Someone will look
it's
at the
40. I actually prefer it. I think it sounds shorter than 39.
Well, it should be.
I feel better than I did yesterday.
I like that indeed. Now, Ian, you've helped arrange this mammoth day for this.
It's not all my fault. It's your mum as well. Basically, very quickly, a few weeks ago, Lee's mum and auntie came into our office here in Norwich and said that it was your birthday today, that you were coming over to celebrate, and that your daughter, or one of your daughters, was called Eadie, named after a certain chap over there. So they were just saying, could we maybe do a little story on it? Any chance of a birthday card?
There she blows. There we go. Oh, absolute shambles.
And, so basically, it just so happened that Dan was in the office, so we called him out and chatting, and that's how it all happened. So here we are today.
Lee hasn't even heard all this.
There we go, Lee. I don't know any. I thought I was going out for dinner. I just thought the taxi driver had taken a really bad route to the restaurant. This is all a bit of a shock. But thank you very much for organising it. It's amazing.
It's all down to you, mum.
It's fantastic for you to be down here, Lee. Why Norwich? How did that come about?
I'm born and bred here. My family is all still here. My dad is still a season ticket holder in the Upper Barclay. My brother is a season ticket holder in Block D in the Lower Barclay. I was a season ticket holder in family enclosure in the Lower River in the Lower Barclay.
When was the last time you saw a game live?
It was horrible. A Norwich game live.
Yeah,
it was horrible. But the last time I was back was the last game of the Premier League season, so I watched that terrible performance against Arsenal.
Yeah.
It was horrible.
The whole thing was horrible, really.
Yeah, it was. It was really quite
That's
terrible.
That's a tough one. What have you made of this year, then? Have you been able to see a lot of it?
Not so much, unfortunately.
You're lucky,
I'm going to move.
Yeah, I'm going to drink up.
Quick,
funnily enough, I do think that it's probably not a bad idea. There does seem to be a bit of a state divide in Australia. I wonder whether it's our sun, the warmth potentially, but we're all quite cup half full.
Excellent.
Whereas there's some phenomenal supporters down in Sydney, Melbourne, South Australia as well, but they're much more doom and gloom.
Miserable.
Yeah, they're much more down than we are. And to be fair, they've been right recently.
Yes,
but, you know.
Absolutely.
Whereas we were still, it's okay, just give him time until I think it's literally. I actually think I bended after you did.
Yeah.
You went early.
Yeah, I was right.
No, you absolutely were. Whereas I think I only caved maybe 3 or 4 weeks ago.
So much to see. It's so brilliant to see you, Lee. Have a fantastic birthday.
Cheers.
Enjoy
Thank
the
you very cake.
And we'll have some champagne. Drink responsibility. Responsibly. And we'll be back in three with lots more. And talk is cheap and stuff.
To the championship.
Welcome to Talk is Cheap, where your calls, questions, comments and posts lead the agenda with me, with Darren Eadie.
Cork's down there, but go and get the cork.
Add that to your collection.
Apparently, you should put a coin in that or something. That's what they do.
Is that right?
Yeah. Okay.
You've had too much.
Keep it forever.
We've of course got Steve Cook and Ian Clarke with us too, and still with us because we kept him in. Lee Woodrow.
Thank you. Thank
Mr. Darren. Brisbane Canary. Should we carry that on the chat? Because the one thing we forgot to mention is your specific bond with Mr. Favourite Player.
Yeah. Well, I grew up. Obviously, I guess I came in through in the heyday of the early 90s, and
it was.
My memories are of particularly against it, just you charging down the lane against Ipswich, and we did a poll probably maybe 2 or 3 years ago, trying to like the best Norwich 11, and I can't remember the whole 11, but
I hope there's a good ending.
As a Canary down under 11, you were in it. There was some discussion about where to put it. Where to play you?
Well, these
to
centre back,
exactly.
A little bit. I think anywhere.
Yeah, I think pretty much the whole back four was that kind of European season back four. I think.
Favourite player, and
hence why your daughter.
Yeah. So my daughter. We struggled with names. My first my first daughter was named after my grandpa. We just added an A to Eric, and then. And then we kind of went backwards and forwards. My wife's middle name is Edith, and. So Edie came into conversation. And I was like, I want to go with that, and I want to put an A in the middle of it and make sure we spell it right. And so it stuck.
Did you explain it at the time? Why? Or did
I did. I think she's probably blocked that from her. She gets, she gets slightly frustrated with my football obsession because it means me getting home at 4 and 5 o'clock in the morning fairly regularly.
Yeah, that must be tough. I mean, I do the live coverage on Pinken, and we have a lot of people from all over the world getting involved, but the people waking up at 4 o'clock instead of 2 o'clock in the morning just to get involved.
Yep, it's amazing, but it's such a camaraderie. There's sort of half a dozen of us really cool that arrive at stupid o'clock in the morning at the pub that we meet at Brisbane Riverside, and then depending on the time, where if it's a 10 o'clock kickoff, there might be 10 or 15 of us. Playoffs, there were 30-odd of us.
Yeah.
But yeah, it can be pretty tricky. It's a big
dedication.
That is something else, I have to say. Right, shall we go on with Talk is Cheap, shall we? This is where, of course, we get your calls and posts. And don't forget, if you get on the live chat on the YouTube.
Shall I have a look at them?
Yeah, we've got some on there already. Don't ring anyone. Important. So we've got our first caller on the line, which I believe is Claire Thomas. Claire, thank you so much for calling in. What would you like to talk about in your Norwich City world?
I don't know. I made an epic journey back from Australia to watch Norwich City on one occasion, and it really wasn't worth the effort. It was a 33-hour journey, and I managed to get back to Norwich in time to watch us lose to Reading 1-0, and it was a total disaster, and I would never encourage anyone to make that much effort ever again.
Wow. That's pretty damning.
I can understand that. And Norwich City as a football club does that to you, doesn't it?
It does. But
sometimes.
But even being further away like that, must have been even more difficult for Leeds.
She must be somewhere. One of the cooler states.
Yeah.
Claire, what have you made of what's been going on at Norwich City recently and in terms of the restructure? Because I suppose we're still maybe not further along from where we were this time last week.
Yeah, nothing's really been happening, has it? But I think I wouldn't be surprised now if we don't get a new manager put in place until the end of the season. I think, you know, we've got an experienced man in charge at the moment. I think it's more important to get the right people in place rather than rush anything. So we've unfortunately got that time now where we can take it to make sure we get the right people in. I think the playoffs are out of reach, so let's use this time wisely and choose the right people. And I'm quite excited about the Juve Rosler link. I think he would be a perfect fit for us, so fingers crossed.
Hold the line there, Claire. Good point. I read a really interesting piece from Juve Rosler, and just he spoke so well. I tended to think about his time at Wigan not really working out, but elsewhere he's done really well. I think we've got some of his quotes, which are just going to fire up. There we go. These are talking about the general sort of setup of English clubs. I think stability in English football is key. That comes with having people between the owners and the coaches. Big fan of the role of sporting director. There it is. Or director of football, of course. He needs to suggest the coach to the board because he has to work with the coach 24/7. For example, I speak to Greta Steinsen, the technical director at Fleetwood, more than I do my wife. And, you know, Fleetwood Town have a technical director, and, you know, some Norwich fans have been a bit sceptical about what Norwich are trying to bring in.
I think if the system works, I think it's really good. If the sporting director is the man in charge, he does the recruitment or oversees the recruitment, oversees the youth development, and the first team coach does exactly that. He's given the players, he has obviously have an input, but he's told, these are your players, get on and sort them out, make them successful. And I think if the clarity's there, the relationship's there, and everyone knows what's going on, I think it can work really well.
I think there's nothing wrong with the system and the structure of what they're trying to do. It's literally down to the individuals they get in to carry that out. Because it's not just about the director of football and the manager. There's probably three or four or five people underneath the director of football that has to be put in place as well, which takes a long time. Southampton have made a real success of it.
Yeah.
But that's taken, what, 5-10 years for them to get it in place, how they wanted it.
Claire, just coming back to you then, I mean, there's still 8 games to go. Is there a little bit of you that's going to be keeping an eye on what Norwich do with the hope of how this season might finish, or are you completely done? I know you kind of touched on it a moment ago.
I'm usually quite a positive and optimistic fan, to be honest, but I have kind of given up the ghost this season a bit. I just think it's out of our reach, and we've got to play six games against the top, teams above us of the next 8 games, and we haven't beaten a team above us all season, so I can't see how we're suddenly going to do that. And no, so I have kind of given up a bit, I think.
That's fine, Claire. I would tend to agree. But thank you so much for your call. Really, really lovely to hear from you. It's a funny old thing, isn't it? Because you speak to Alan ever, so it's smelling your hair. It does smell really nice.
Thank you.
So don't normally get to sit this close, do we? It's absolutely easy. In terms, I mean, Norwich, they have struggled to beat these teams above them, and we've just can't see it in them, can we? That they could turn that round over the next 8 games.
See, you're so
negative. Away from home.
I can see it. If you're going to play the teams that you need to beat to get above, you want to be playing the ones that are above you. That's the way I look at it, because you're in control of your own destiny. Then they are capable of beating decent teams, you know, on occasions.
That's the thing, though, isn't it? It's on occasions. Yeah. It's like you have to do that week after week now.
But if they do put a run in together to the end of the season now against those teams, there's every chance they can get themselves back in. And it's only going to take one. They win that first one, and then they only become 2 points off the playoffs. Everybody else above them starts to panic a little bit as well and starts to look at Norwich as a threat.
I reckon if we got a run together, no one in that top six would want to play us. Because everyone would look at our squad and go, if they're on fire, I don't want to be trying to beat them.
It's curious, isn't it? We're talking about that with a manager who's temporarily in charge. It just seems like it's a strange situation. We have got a tweet just on Juve Rosler as well, which is from Lil. I don't get the positivity towards Rosler. I mean, please help me, Norwich fans. What has he done that makes you all so keen on him? Go on then. Anyone?
I think he's got his pluses and minuses, like any manager. I think, again, sometimes it just takes a little bit of luck and the structure you've got around you. If it's not right, and no manager can perform, but I think he's a capable manager. But whether he'll suit a director of football, and they've got to get on, first of all. The interesting part is, if Stuart Webber does come in, I would imagine that he already had somebody in place for when Wagner leaves, or Wagner, whenever he leaves.
Webber.
So if he leaves and comes to Norwich, has he already got in mind the manager he wants anyway?
And what happens if Irvine does take us on a run to the playoffs, and beyond that, does he have to then be in the mix? If he gets us in the playoffs and we go up, say, can you then say to Irvine, sorry, we've got somebody else in mind, cheerio?
Southampton did.
Yeah.
Southampton let managers go if it wasn't the right person.
And that the structure, what they put in with that the way it is with that director of football, that is what it's about. It is about the managers becoming commodities as much as players do.
Yep.
Brett Harvey has been in touch on the YouTube,
YouTube
chat. Get in touch. He says, out of current front runners, who would you have as the head coach over Paul Heckingbottom, Rosler, or Darrell Clarke? You had a lot of love for Darrell Clarke last week, Steve.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest with you, it goes back to what Darren was saying. I think, you know, job titles are one thing, but you've got to have people who have clear remits, and you've got to get the right dynamic, because you can't have an old-fashioned manager who kind of expects to do certain things. They've got to be used to playing under a sporting director. For me, I think it's going to be someone completely left field that, you know, comes out of nowhere and you kind of go, who's he? But actually, provided they complement each other and that sporting director role.
I think it's got to. I think it's almost got to be a foreign manager. Look, because I think the group of players that Norwich have got at the moment, anything than someone that's a big name as a manager, or someone a bit left field from the Bundesliga or something like that, I'm not sure they're going to get the kind of respect from those group of players that they should expect from a new manager. But
And who'd heard of Wagner, whatever his name is.
Exactly that.
Before we went to Huddersfield.
Yeah.
How do you pronounce it?
David Wagner. If you say Alec Neil, you say David Wagner. Hop Jump Fly has been in touch. Who do you guys think will leave this summer, presumably in terms of playing squad? And this is a nice, juicy debate to get
How long you got?
Yeah.
Well, I've actually done my column for this week on who I think should stay.
Should stay, that's probably it.
So I've kept 17 out of the 27. I've got rid of 10.
Okay.
And I know it's going to cause a bit of a stir tomorrow. I think Yannick Wiltshire is on my get rid of list, which I know is going to cause a storm, but he's done nothing for me. One shot on target in 7 games. I think he can go.
But it's easy to say to get rid of them, though, isn't it? But how do you shift them
That's
on?
That's a really good
That's
point.
That's the problem. Yeah,
that's the point. Because if it were that easy, we'd have lost some in the January.
I mean, Lafferty clearly would have gone ages ago if Alec Neil could have got rid of him.
Who, sorry?
Alec
there will be players that Norwich won't have to worry about because their contract will run out. That's a job done. Mm. It's the ones where they may still be in contract, the ones, the decisions over their options, but also the players that other teams want to come and buy that Norwich might want to hang on to. Mm. They might not have an option. We've got Sam Jeremy on the phone. Sam, thank you so much for ringing in. The floor is yours. What would you like to talk about?
You all right, guys? Yeah, just sort of following on really from the... talking about sort of the new sort of setup with sporting director and head coach and how that's going to pan out, really.
How do you think it's going to pan out, Sam? Go on, you tell us. What are you worried about or looking forward to?
Well, to me, it seems like it's all going to hinge on whether we get this Stuart Webber guy in from Huddersfield. It seems to me like the club's kind of sort of made him sort of... number one target, and hopefully we get him because it seems like that's the man we want, and he seems like he's got a really sort of impressive sort of track record over the last few years. My only worry is are Huddersfield going to want to keep hold of him? Are we actually going to get him? And then obviously it seems like we have to get the sporting director in before there's really sort of any final decision made on the head coach, because obviously that relationship is going to be key to how we move forward.
I think it's time now that Norwich can't settle for second best in their first approach. They've got to get it right the first time, haven't they? If they want Stuart Webber, they've got to get him.
Well, this is who they want. As far as I know, it's kind of the primary target. It was always going to be him. It will happen. It's just about sorting the compensation deal with Huddersfield, by all accounts. So it's just that waiting, I suppose, for them, the next step, while you wait for Stuart Webber, which is what makes it really awkward. And he's a man who's in a hurry. He's had a lot of jobs at lots of places and done really well. We've got someone who's got a really good reputation. But you want the sporting director to hang around, don't you, Clarkie? Because he's kind of the continuity that you want.
And interestingly, this time next week, plus 15 minutes, Norwich are playing at Huddersfield. So I think that whole dynamic as well, clearly where both clubs are at the moment, is going to make things a bit awkward.
Well, they're all going to be in the same room at that point, aren't they? And they have to say, if it comes down to them physically being at the same stadium at a time to discuss it, that's the way football works, isn't it?
And perhaps that's part of the deal, is nothing happens till after the game is done.
It could be. It could be. With stranger old things. Sam, I'm interested, obviously, who would you like as head coach rather than sporting director? And of course, David Wagner, there is a suggestion that he'll obviously have a lot of offers, but Norwich, and if Stuart Webber came here, they might like David Wagner. But who would you like as head coach?
Well, it's funny because before the new structure was kind of announced, I was really sort of heavily in favour for an experienced sort of manager. I wasn't convinced with the likes of Pardew and all the rest of it, and I kind of was sort of saying at the start of the season I'd love to have someone in like Steve Bruce who has that track record of getting promoted out of this league. But it seems now we're going to go for a head coach who may possibly not have that kind of years of experience, but is going to sort of have that tactical nous. And to be honest with you, it sounds like in terms of getting Webber in, he's really going to sort of have an idea of who you want, and I kind of trust people like that to make a decent decision. The only thing with Wozniak, it seems like he does jump about quite a lot from club to club, and I'm not sure whether there's a loyalty factor there, whether times are tough, or whether he gets another offer, whether he's just going to jump ship in another season or two.
Do you think that the success of Huddersfield had this season, Norwich have almost jumped on top of that quite quickly to think that's the way we want to go, because they were clearly probably the best team I've seen down at Carrow Road this season. Do you think that's kind of swung the board's view on the structure of where they want to go forward now, just purely because of how well Huddersfield have done it?
Quite possibly, yeah, because obviously they came down to Carrow Road before Christmas, and it was almost embarrassing, because I think at the time we had at least £20-25 million worth of players on our bench who weren't even starting that game. In contrast, Huddersfield was put together, you know, with an absolute pittance. But the difference between the work rate and the energy, and they caused us real problems, and obviously we lost the game. So I think that was a really kind of sobering moment for someone like Norwich, who obviously come down from the Championship, got the parachute payments and got the finances to do something, and got the finances to bring in the likes of Pritchard for £8 million. But then you look to someone like Huddersfield, who have just sort of risen up from like the depths of the league with this structure. And I think it's hard. It's hard to ignore it, you know.
I'm quite excited by it, I have to say.
But just for your call,
just hope it's not too much of a knee-jerk reaction from one success.
Do you know what? Whether it's Webber or not, what I'd want from the sporting director is a strategy. Because for me, the biggest problem that we've got as a club is the disconnect between the recruitment side and the first team, and also the academy. Because if you look at the players that have come through, the Murphys are obviously, you know, the big example. But there's precious little else.
Yeah.
And similarly, in terms of the recruitment side, you don't feel that there's a kind of coherency in terms of they've identified the kind of succession plans for players. And it all seems a bit knee-jerk. So for me, what I want from the sporting director is to have that clarity of like, OK, this is the way that the club's going. These are the players that we're going to bring through. These are the players that we need to recruit. These are the players that are coming through the academy.
Which other clubs do so well.
Yeah.
Some of them certainly. Johnny Woodbeast is on YouTube.
Of course he is.
Don't joke. His real name. Yeah, he says he's going to Villa, but I can't see us finding our backbone. Hope I'm wrong. And then he does ask a question as well. Guys, who do you think, why do you think all has gone quiet on the Webber front?
I think compensation, and purely because they're playing them soon. I think that's that no decisions will be made until, well, decisions have probably already been made, but I don't think anything will be announced until the game's over.
Indeed.
And we've always done things quite quietly as well. Like I generally think the club are quite respectful in the way they go about their business.
I agree with that, most definitely. George Reid, he says, hi, Norwich will not make the playoffs.
Cheers.
Thanks, George. But he does come back.
Question mark.
Will Norwich... Will,
hashtag ITFC.
There's a question. George.
Strong vote, Jake.
The level of our sound effects has gone up tenfold in literally the last 4 years. He does come back. Will Norwich go up next season if they don't go up this season? Let's do our 2017-18 preview now, boys.
If we had a crystal ball. I think massively that this summer is huge. Probably the biggest it's been in decades for Norwich in terms of shifting people in and recruitment coming in. It's going to be an exciting, fresh, new look to the start of the season, I think.
Yeah, I agree.
And having that structure, having two men rather than one, will be the biggest managerial change and probably the biggest change in playing staff as well. You know, if we do get rid of 8-10 players, I can't remember that bigger cull for many years.
Serious change. Right, we've got our third caller on the line. Sam Walden is with us. Sam, good evening to you. Thanks so much for ringing. Appreciate that. What would you like to talk about?
I was wondering whether with Stuart Webber likely to come in, if he will be persuaded Wagner to join him in the summer.
I presume, Sam, he'd be the one that you would want Stuart to have a word with. I mean, what have you made of Huddersfield this year? Because they have been phenomenal, really.
Oh, well, I think they've been the surprise of the league for me. There's always a surprise. And even after the start of the season, when I think they lost 6 or 7 out of 8, they've regrouped and galvanised. And personally, unless Norwich somehow get in the playoffs, I hope Huddersfield are the team that go up from them.
Do you think that actually... Dare I say it, look, Norwich has become too small for Wagner. I think he's got a bigger job in him now. I think he's you know, he said he turned down Wolfsburg, didn't he?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Is Norwich a bit too small for him now? Has he got bigger fish to fry?
And Huddersfield really dug in over keeping Wagner at that point too. So what do you think, Sam?
What do I think? I think he might be liking it in England. I think we're bigger than Huddersfield. I don't know whether he will go to another club. He might decide to stick at England, unless, of course, we decide to stick with Irvine until the end of the season, which for me is fine. And then there's other managers available. But if we were to get a manager now, I'd like us to go all out for Wagner and see what happens.
Brilliant, Sam. One more question. Who's the one player you'd like to keep a hold of?
One player I'd like to keep hold of? I'd probably say Ryan Bennett out of the out-of-contract ones. But I don't want to see Johnny Howson go.
That's fair enough.
It's amazing.
So we don't want to see Leeds go up, is what we're saying.
Well, but it's amazing he hasn't gone already. I don't know, he just keeps sort of floating under the radar.
It's a bit like that, isn't it? You kind of wonder how we've been lucky enough to hold on to him.
It's been great.
Sam, thank you so much for your call. Love having Sam on the show. He's a good boy, Sam.
Good chap.
Right, we got a tweet, have we, I believe? One more tweet from Daryl Russell. This again on Peter Oldfield, sending his condolences. I think Pete dealt with so many of the players that you've kind of seen that at the time. Really well. Did you know him?
Yeah, I knew him really well. The most kindest, gentlest man you'll ever meet that'd do anything for you. And he was he's one of those kind of bricks in the wall at Carrow Road that was always going to be there. Yeah, really sad.
And he loved the club, didn't he? That's the thing that came out in whatever he did.
Massively. But even if, I mean, you remember after games and having a chat with Pete, and if we'd had a poor performance, he'd always lift you. He was very good at doing that. Sometimes it's very difficult, I think, for players to kind of mix with staff within the football club, but he just had that natural ability of making you feel at ease and comfortable and want to speak to him. He was a good, great chap.
Brilliant stuff. And Daryl obviously hasn't played for the club for 10 years, remember Peter well. Lee, time's almost done. How long are you back in Norwich for? What are you going to do with yourself? What a key time to be around.
Well, we've just done London. We had the Brisbane Canaries down under flag out at Wembley at the weekend, which was thrilling.
Fantastic. Got highlight probably, actually.
Yeah, indeed. We're here for the Norwich Reading game. I've got my 40th birthday on Saturday night, and then we fly out on the 12th.
But any more babies? Have a little halty on the way?
who would be next?
We feel outnumbered with two. There's no need for a third one. They're wonderful, but two's fine, I think, for the time.
Yeah, that's no problem at all. And it sounds like there's quite a lot of Norwich fans over
in Australia. Huge number. And and it's not just English sort of expats as well. There's a young girl by the name of Courtney who rocks up every single week, and big crowd of guys, and she's only in kind of, I'm guessing, late teens, I think, and hers is from a family thing, so she finishes work at stupid o'clock at night, comes straight down to the pub, watches the game, and she's utterly obsessed. It's amazing.
That must be a really nice community feel to it.
It's fabulous.
And you must be the star now, after this.
I
would think so, yeah. It usually gets shared on the Facebook page and that kind of thing. And I'd imagine there'll be a fair bit of chat now, which is... it's been amazing. Thank you for having me.
Lee, it's been an absolute pleasure. Enjoy your cake. Enjoy the rest of your time here. Fingers crossed for Reading. Yeah. It must be better than the Arsenal game, sure.
Yes, indeed.
That is us done for Talk is Cheap. A huge thank you to all your calls, tweets and comments, of course. If you want to get involved in future, it's simpler than ever. Just get in touch via the pink and message boards or drop us an email to sport@mustardtv.co.uk. And if you want to see it all over again, you can catch all our Norwich City content on our Norfolk Now YouTube channel. That's it for part two. The Pink and Show returns after the break as we preview the resumption of championship battles live. Still live.
Can I stay here? Can I stay here?
Maybe. We'll see you in three.
mozzarella dip.
There's the lot laughing. Now, talking about food. Talking about food is not fair. Welcome back to the final part of tonight's Pinken Show with Darren Eadie, Steve Cook, and Ian Clarke. So, it's back. City are 5 points off the pace, and they've five big games coming up in under 3 weeks to prove a lot of people wrong, me included. It all starts in Villa Park on Saturday before City head to high-flying Huddersfield Town on Wednesday. I know what you're thinking. Two away trips!
That's a rubbish stat, the one at the end there.
Oh, come on.
How many games has he had? Stats. How many games has he had? Two.
It's a bit unbeaten. He is unbeaten. Well, and now, Norwich's away record. We're not going to have that conversation again, obviously. Yeah. But the proper tests coming up now, isn't it? The Huddersfield and Villa. I mean, Norwich's record at Villa is shocking anyway. But.
Well, it is. But like I said, if you're in that position, they're the teams you want to play. The ones that, well, not Villa, not in and around them, but the teams that are up at the top. Because they're almost become six-pointers. And if you start to beat a couple of the ones up and around the top of the area, as I said, all the other teams in that,
momentum's
in and around
a big
you.
Thing,
yeah, yeah, but then they start to look at it and think, oh, they've just beat those two sides. They're capable.
Which is why these two games are so important, isn't it? Because that is what sets that tempo and
definitely
that momentum, Steve. At the moment, we're just looking at the fact they haven't beaten a team in the top nine and they're rubbish away from home. And that needs to change immediately.
It does, but I think the stat was up there. Villa have won 5 in 6. So, you know, because they're below us in the table, you might think, OK, nothing to play for. But they're a team in form. And I think their chair or their CEO came out and saying, again, they're targeting promotion for next year. They've obviously got a bit of momentum. And the problem that I have is that every time that we've had half a chance this season, we've fallen flat on our faces. Mm. And that's the worry for me.
Well, I'll tell you what, before we come back to discuss Villa ourselves, let's hear from a Villa fan, shall we? Earlier today, I spoke to vlogger Jordan Ray about their season, starting with whether their campaign had been as much of a disaster as some have made out.
It's been a bit of a strange one, to be honest. Di Matteo came in, we had the new owners, we were very optimistic. For me, playoffs was a bare minimum. We then changed managers, Steve Bruce came in, and the idea behind that was a promotion specialist. He'll know, you know, exactly what we need to do to get out the division. And it started off quite well. That was followed by a very poor December and January. And finally, we look to have picked up results. But unfortunately, it is too little too late.
Yeah.
So overall, I would say it has been a disappointing season. But there's certainly signs of improvement for the next campaign.
And I guess the key is you guys want to keep the faith with Steve Bruce, I guess, because as you said, he was brought in to bring promotion. He's got such a fantastic track record.
Yeah, I think it would be the right decision to stick with Steve Bruce. He's got the track record. He knows how to get out the division. My only concern would be we are putting a lot of pressure on ourselves to go up next season. We've spent a lot of money, spent a lot of money on wages as well. And with the likes of financial fair play and the parachute payments, which are going to get less, you know, it's imperative that we go up next season, so the pressure will be on.
Yeah, they have spent a lot of money. Are you surprised it hasn't worked, or was the money with a view to it taking more than this season, effectively?
I think the idea, especially in January with the purchases we made, was to go up this season. You know, we got the likes of Scott Hogan in, proven track record at scoring goals, got the likes of Conor Hooran in, proven track record of getting assists and really, you know, attacking from a midfield position. But I think it took Steve Bruce longer than expected to find the right formation and the right system. As a result of that, it is too little too late. But hopefully now we have got the right formation, the right system for us to push forward in the next campaign.
It's interesting because obviously Norwich and Villa have been in a similar state of affairs this season. How have you guys viewed Norwich's season from afar?
I think, again, there's been, you know, a managerial change, obviously recently with Alex Neil getting sacked. You know, there's a lot of changes with yourselves up at the sort of the boardroom level with Steve Stone being brought in as managing director. So I think in terms of our review Norwich's season, ups and downs like Aston Villa, but I think you're in a better position to go up than we are, and I still wouldn't rule that out for yourselves. I think, you know, there is scope there for you to make a late charge for the playoffs.
Fingers crossed, Jordan. Fingers crossed, indeed. Now, does it feel like Villa have a decent record against Norwich recently? Certainly at Villa Park.
Certainly at Villa Park, we do. I remember we had our fixture earlier in the season, and I feel that was the fixture that kept Alex Neil in a job. If I'm honest, your 1-0 win over us. I think if you had have lost that game, you would have maybe pulled the plug on Alex Neil a little bit earlier. But I think that was a big result for yourselves and kept him in a job for longer than expected. It's going to be very tough. People talked about the Sheffield Wednesday fixture that we had a few weeks ago as being a real big test for us. Can we do well against the team that are pushing at the sort of the higher positions in the table? As it turns out, Sheffield Wednesday had a man sent off. We ended up winning that game, but it didn't really tell us a lot. I feel that the game we're going to have against yourselves over the weekend will be a real indicator for us as to whether, you know, that this team can push forward for the rest of this season and next season. And it's obviously a big fixture for yourselves as well. I feel that if you can get the 3 points over us, you're in a very good position there to compete for those playoff places.
Brilliant stuff, Jordan. We've just got time for a score prediction. Go for it. Give us a score.
I think both teams score a lot of goals, so I'm going to go for 3-2 Aston Villa.
Some good stuff there from Jordan. So here's what the weekend has in store. Derby kick things off on Friday night before Villa Park hosts one of the big games of the day. Brighton, Huddersfield, Newcastle and Preston are all at home, while Saturday's late kickoff at the Medeski Stadium should be well worth a watch. The entire division are in action again in midweek, with most games on Tuesday. But City eyes will be on Wednesday, when Norwich travel to Huddersfield, of course, and come the following Saturday, Norwich host promotion hopefuls Reading. Friday's Sports Extra will have all the top lines from City's pre-match press conference. You'll be able to catch those also on our YouTube channel, along with our videos from Villa Park and John Smith Stadium. So if you see me, come and say hello. 11s then for Saturday's trip to Villa Park. Should we have a look at one of those? Clarkie, we've got yours first. Here we go. This is your 11 for Saturday.
I've actually gone 4-4-2 because I'm a bit old-fashioned.
I didn't know you could play like that anymore.
No, I don't think you can. It's probably against the law, but I thought I'd give it a go. I just want to see us go for it a bit more. I mean, if we are going to go up, we've got to go out and attack. Closest back in for me. I know there's been a big debate over him. Dykes is still out, so I'm not a massive fan of Whittaker, and he's on my cull list, but he's probably the only hope.
That is drastic.
Don't fancy playing
Wilshere?
No,
he's gone, mate.
You're going to sell
him, aren't you? He's sold. £3 million.
He's really on the bus.
And of course, Wes Houlihan is probably going to be injured for a few weeks, we imagine. But that sounds like it's exactly. That could be a fair amount of time. Steve, let's have a look at your 11, shall we? Is it much different?
I've got closer in there. I've stuck to the tried and tested form. Fact is, right, I think the playoffs have gone. And yet, until it's mathematically impossible, I want to kind of keep I want to keep it as it is. Part of me wants to throw in the youth. Part of me wants to give Madison a go and just say, right, do you know what? This season's gone, so give him a chance. But until it's mathematically impossible, I'm kind of sticking to a tried and tested.
It's not the right time now. We said this before, you know.
Because there has been a clamour for this, hasn't there? Yeah. From a lot of fans.
But the time to test them was having them on the bench against Forest and Brentford when they're pummeling them, and then stick them on for 10 minutes, 10, 15 minutes, just to get them in the changing rooms and all that. Not now, when you are struggling. Difficult for a lad when things aren't going well.
And with one up top, Cameron, rather than...
Yeah,
he's done nothing wrong as he can. I think he warrants his place at the moment. And you know, you got Oliveira off the bench, but
we'll play both.
there we go. Good fighting talk, like
and just too traditional, Clarkie. That's the problem.
We are going to start talking about player of the season as well, aren't we? Because we've got eight. I mean, the Championship have already named their team of the season, so you know, Cam is going to be right up there amongst
that's that. Johnny H.
It's got to be
Johnny H.
For me, he's the one we talked about. The players who'd leave. I'd build the side around Johnny H for next season and going forward, and make him captain. And I'd basically say, right, you know, from now on, you are the heart and soul of this team.
You've read my column for tomorrow already. I've read your mind. For me, it's Housen, Jerome, Jacob Murphy, my top three.
I think I, in terms of building a team around a player next season, Alex Pritchard. Predictions for Saturday or Huddersfield? How many points in the two games? How about that?
In the two games, I will go a steady 4 points.
Okay. Which, will that be an
beat Villa, draw Huddersfield.
I think that'd be an excellent 4 points.
I reckon we'll get a couple of points. I reckon we'll draw them both.
Clarkey?
I'm going to go draw at Villa and lose at Huddersfield.
So 1 point out of six.
1 point out of six.
I have to say, that's what was what going through my head as one, well. One point. I think they'll draw one, maybe, if they're lucky. And on that note, we're done for tonight. If you missed any of the show, do not worry. It will be available to watch on our Norfolk Now YouTube channel. Donut. I'm hungry.
Donuts.
And it's that McDonald's talk. And repeated regularly on mustard. Am I allowed to say McDonald's? Probably not. Now, with Norwich City in action next Wednesday night in Huddersfield, I'm already looking forward to that trip. Of course, we are going to take a week off. So the Pinken Show will return in a fortnight. That's Wednesday, April the 12th, live from 7 p.m. on Mustard and on YouTube, to make sure you join us then. But for now, a big thank you to Darren Eadie, Steve Cook, Ian Clarke here in the studio, Brisbane Canary, all our callers, commenters and tweeters, producer Jake and the Mustard team, and to you for watching. Until next time, here's to there being some life left in Norwich City season. Good night.